Today I'm honoured to have Professor Uta Frith on the show. She's a developmental psychologist with special interest in autism and dyslexia. She is an emeritus professor, I hope I'm pronouncing that right,
of
cognitive development at the University of College of London. She is the woman responsible for the mainstreaming of Asperger's syndrome, and her pioneering work has helped to identify autism as a physiological condition, dispelling any myths about bad parenting. So it's my absolute pleasure to welcome Uta to the show. Hello, Uta, and thank you so, so much for this opportunity.
Hello, Sharon, and thank you for inviting me.
Great. I'm so excited. I won't say any more, only that I'm very, very excited. I'm a huge fan and I've been following you on lots of different things, and I'm really, really, really impressed and a big fan of your work.
Oh, thank you.
So Uta, I suppose we'll get right to it. So my first question would be, why did you choose the area of autism to specialise in?
Well, you know, this is actually quite a difficult question for me, because I think it's a little bit my special interest. It's my savoir-skill. It's just like that. I just find it utterly fascinating. And I think it's an absolute, you know, autism is like a key to understanding ourselves as human beings. We haven't found that key yet, I have to admit. But it's really very difficult to say why I find it so fascinating. It just is. And I think you probably can ask the same question about, you know, some of the skills that you find in autism. You say, you know, here's somebody who's developed an expertise and a fascination with a narrow subject. Why? We never know.
Yeah, true. Listen, Uta, I'm aware that when you first started in the field of autism, it was thought that it was an environmentally based condition and that bad parenting was one of the most prevalent reasons cited for this. I know Bethlehem's refrigerator mother was a big movement at the time. In your opinion, is this something that we've completely dispelled, or is it something that people still believe in somewhat today?
Oh, I think really, really this has changed, and thank God it has. And it's very, very remarkable, because we still don't know the cause of autism. But then we really no longer believe in witchcraft that might, you know, cause these things that we don't know what causes them, you know, all sorts of illnesses. We just know that eventually people will get to this incredibly complex business of finding the genetic predispositions and the interactions with one gene and another, and all sorts of very, very complicated things about brain development. This is where autism originates. We know that roughly. And I'm really very certain that eventually we will find the purely biological cause. So whenever people talk about, you know, oh, it can't be just genetic because, you know, you have some differences in twins, for example, who have identical genes, so it must be the environment. And that's very interesting, because environment is very often understood as a kind of, you know, upbringing, kind of, you know, mothering, parenting, social environment. But that is not the way that environment should be understood when we talk about causes of development, of brain development. The environment here is something very, very different. It's really like random events that happen all the time, because it's such a hazardous thing to develop a brain. You know, everything can go wrong. The miracle is that so often it doesn't.
Yeah, no, I suppose it's great to think that these myths are finally being dispelled and that parents don't feel responsible for it anymore.
Yes.
Do you know?
Thank God.
Listen, Uta, next question for you is, the theory of mind theory is long established as a theory in autism. Will you explain to my listeners a little bit about both what implicit and explicit theory of mind is and what the implication is for it on functional behaviours in an individual with autism?
Well, I will try. It's not so easy. First of all, what do we mean by implicit and explicit? Actually, it's the unconscious bit, that's
okay.
The implicit bit. You never know, you're never aware of what we're doing there. And explicit is what we consciously do. So we do have a totally unconscious way of navigating the social space. I always use the analogy of a GPS.
Okay.
You know where you are. It's so easy. You know, you're supposed to turn left, you're supposed to turn right. And you can just remember where you were before. It's all given to you for free and nothing. But of course, it's also very useful to have a map. And that you have to learn. And that's what I would say is very conscious, very deliberate. And you know the situation of the social world,
yeah,
which you can also very consciously think about. It's not just knowing what somebody will do immediately the next millisecond, but sort of remembering on what terms you were with them a long time ago, what they might feel about you, these kinds of things. You can very explicitly think about it.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing is that all of these abilities to navigate in social space, just like our ability to navigate in geographical space, have a basis in the brain.
Okay.
And the idea really is that in autism, something very subtle must have gone wrong in brain development so that just this particular GPS, not the geographical GPS, but that social GPS is somehow not there.
Okay.
And of course, it doesn't mean that you couldn't learn about maps. That is a more difficult task because, you know, you have to consciously do it. You have to put in effort. You have to be a bit older. But it works as a system.
Okay.
So that is why it's very useful to make a difference between the implicit theory of mind, which we like to call mentalizing, and the explicit theory of mind, which is sort of consciously attributing intentions to others or beliefs or desires.
Okay. And Uta, to what extent, if any, does an individual's personality and their individual differences influence a person's theory of mind, their ability to attribute those mental states to others, and what in turn how does this influence their own mental well-being?
Oh, it's very good that you are mentioning personality, individual differences in personality. It's often just not mentioned, but everyone knows that absolutely every child is different. And that's true for autistic children, learning disabled children, anybody at all. The personality is always there. And it's incredibly important in what happens, how you adapt to any slight difficulty you have, or how you may use the kind of cognitive strengths you have. So, yes, there is a huge influence. So personality is, of course, again, something you can't take responsibility for. It's there. We don't know how. It has a genetic origin. And it's really weird that everybody is different from everybody else.
Yeah. So
it's like a fingerprint. But some of us are luckier with their personality or their temperament than others.
Absolutely.
And of course, they have a far better ability to negotiate. So a particularly important thing with, you know, when you think about autism is if they happen to be people who like other people, you know, to like, yeah, to be with other people, do what other people do, like what other people like, that's a wonderful personality trait if you're autistic.
Yeah.
Because then you can use that kind of situation, that kind of motivation to learn about the social world. And that's really amazingly powerful. Now, I'm not saying that in ordinary human beings, everybody should be, you know, conforming to others and like what others like. We also like the non-conformists.
Yeah,
we need
true.
Those as well. You know, otherwise we would always be the sort of herd, you know, who,
yeah,
who follow, you know, some kind of whim or fashion. So that these are all these individual differences. And they happen in autism just like in anybody else.
Perfect. And by the same vein, Uta, do you find that males and females meet differing challenges regarding an impairment in theory of mind, or is it pretty much standard across gender?
Well, it's really, really one of the sort of pressing questions at the moment, and I've always wondered about this. I mean, it seemed to me that girls who were autistic, they're often very, very severely impaired, and they couldn't show a lot of compensatory learning. You know, you just need a lot of resources to do this compensatory learning. So there you could see girls and boys not being very different at that sort of very severe type of autism.
Okay.
But then you get to the more milder types. If they're milder is another question. But anyway, those where, you know, you have pretty good cognitive abilities, and it seems to me that somehow the girls as a group are more likely to be like to please other people, to be with other people, to like what others like. It's just an impression.
Okay.
And that would be a fabulous gateway for them to learn and to also to camouflage any problems that they might have. If they somehow imitate what others do, they learn what others do. And therefore, girls could be, you know, much better off in many ways, being much more invisible. Of course, some people say that's not necessarily a good thing because, you know, it's like if you were blind and you didn't ever tell anybody about this, that would be surely not a good idea.
Yeah.
So this is an area, I think, where people are studying a lot to just find out what these differences between girls and boys, men and women, really are. We are all quite puzzled about them.
Perfect, perfect. Uta, weak central coherence. I know that this is another groundbreaking theory in explaining how some individuals with autism function. Will you explain to my listeners what this theory suggests and again how it relates to everyday functioning for the person with autism?
Well, weak central coherence was an idea that has always, you know, been a little bit troublesome to me because I originally wanted to explain the actual strength of people with autism. You know, we always look for deficits and difficulties, but I knew that there were amazing strengths. For example, the special interests. For example, you know, the really amazing attention to detail.
Yeah.
And it seemed to me that there might be a trade-off between strong central coherence, which is always look at the whole picture, forget about the detail, and weak central coherence, which is be interested in the detail, and maybe your interest is so important and so much captured by the detail that you cannot see the whole picture. So you miss out on the overall meaning. It seemed to me that that could be something that explains a lot of the, you know, somewhat puzzling, both strengths and some weaknesses in autism. But meanwhile, this theory hasn't actually really been supported very much.
Okay.
So we now know that this is something that is actually shared across the neurotypical population. So I'm one of these people, I think, a bit high on this weak central coherence. Scientists and artists in general, because they need to attend to detail. They need to be a bit obsessive. You know, as I've said, I'm completely obsessive in my narrow interest in autism. I might forget about all sorts of other important things just because I'm so captured by it. But I think that this is, you know, part of our individual differences. It's not something that's somehow uniquely associated with autism, I now believe. And we know from more recent work that, well, it might be true, it might be a good description of a proportion of people with autism. It explains a lot about their, you know, savant skills, that kind of thing, repetitiveness, some obsessive tendencies. But it is sort of like it has a separate genetic root. It's like in addition to the social things. It's not as if those two things always have to go together.
Okay. Okay. As we know, Uta, impairment in social imagination is one of the core deficits in autism. However, many of our autistic individuals find it difficult to come up with creative ideas too, which would be separate from that social imagination. I'd assume,
by social imagination, we think of the ability to stand in somebody else's shoes.
Exactly.
And not just one other person, but many people in very different circumstances from our own. It's quite a difficult thing. And, of course, it's the sort of thing that I suppose writers have, people who can write novels about imaginary people in worlds that they've never themselves been in. And it's quite amazing. And it is true, as far as I know, that autistic people are not very interested in these kinds of stories and that kind of fiction. I'm not so sure whether we can say that in autism it's a total lack of imagination. It surely they have creativity.
Yeah.
Surely, because very often they by personality they might be nonconformist, different, rebellious even. They might come up with their own very interesting ideas, but they're not likely to have to do with really taking on the perspective of somebody very different from them. And that is sort of what we capture often by the word, being egocentric.
Yeah.
It's not something which we can tell them to snap out of, That's the thing. You can tell a neurotypical child not to be so selfish, not to be so egocentric, but to an autistic child, that is like, that just, they can't do that, I think. They are really, that is one of their defining features, that they are egocentric.
Perfect. Uta, with regards to all the theories that we're discussing, do you have any suggestions that my listeners could use, how they could use these theories at a functional level to support the individuals that they live with autism?
Well, I think it is really, really helpful to try and understand what's going on in the mind of a person with autism. I think that understanding is really important to help with the sort of management of, even difficult situations and in general coping with sometimes, challenging behaviour. And I think above all, these theories should be a way of making sure that you don't blame yourself or blame the autistic person.
Perfect.
Really understand that the way that they're set out to develop and to do things is not entirely in their control.
Okay, that's a very good point, actually.
Sorry. A lot of coughing.
No, you're fine. I think we're all in the same boat. I've been turning down the microphone here to cough discreetly, so we're both in the same boat. I think that's a really good point, Uta, because I know I speak to a lot of parents who worry that their behaviour is affecting their child with autism, and it's actually important that people realise that it isn't down to their behaviours or their parenting again,
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the way that, you try to make sense of behaviours, and a very easy way in our sort of everyday life is to blame.
Yeah,
to
absolutely.
Blame ourselves or somebody else, preferably.
Absolutely.
And with a condition like, any developmental disorder, you should not do that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a normal human tendency, but just say stop it.
Yeah. Breathe, take those 5 seconds of breath just to prevent yourself, I suppose.
Yes.
Uta, another question for you. Now, something you're very well known for is your translating of Hans Asperger papers into English in 1991. Yes. And I know that its subsequent introduction into the DSM-4 did change the face of society's understanding of autism, allowing for individuals with less classical presentations to acquire a diagnosis. How do you feel about Asperger's syndrome's removal from the latest manual? And it appears now from the ICD-11, it seems to be removed as well.
I have very mixed feelings about this.
Okay.
I think it was very important to somehow make people aware that autism doesn't necessarily mean severe learning disability. And Asperger's syndrome was needed as a separate kind of a label to allow people to be diagnosed who just didn't have that severe learning disability. I think that was an important step forward. You couldn't have said, oh, yeah, it's also autism.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's different. That's not quite enough. But maybe now we've done it, maybe, okay, now you can forget about it. Now you can. Now you understand that autism can occur in all kinds of, you know, atypical forms and so on.
Yeah.
Now we don't need the label anymore. I suppose that is, you know, an argument I can certainly understand.
Okay. I suppose it was definitely a stepping stone, and definitely it did forge the way